business design is something you think about kind of fundamentally as you start a company. Well, I'm going to lay out my organization. But what's the definition of new business design?
Right. Whether you're a corporate entrepreneur inside a corporation or an independent entrepreneur, they have similarities. They're different species, really, but they have very significant similarities. Not enough of these groups actually intentionally sit down and think about the overall business design. What happens is you have a product idea, or you have a new service you want to bring to market, or maybe you're thinking about how to change the supply chain to add significant value to the business. But changes you make there, or products that you try and throw out to market over here, might require changes to the other ways that you do business. And as I said before, we really should be thinking about these as an intentional set of decisions, as opposed to we focus on the product, we get the technology right, isn't this exciting? And then as we near market, oh gosh, I guess we better figure out how to manage our supply chain for this. Or man, let's go call those project management people because they screwed it up. When in fact, it was my fault because I didn't think about these issues up front. I mean, it sounds very prosaic, but that kind of stuff happens all the time, especially in new product launches. But I want to give you a great example of a failure. And I love finding examples of failure when people are willing to talk about it. They're golden for the classroom and for the practitioner, too. So there are examples of exactly the same product coming to market, two different companies, and both companies agree exactly the same product, where one is exceptionally successful and the other one is a dismal failure. One example is in the telecom equipment space, a local company called Telabs. They came up with a product called the Titan 6500. They sent it out to market through their existing channels, existing customers, existing salespeople. So they just kind of tossed it into their salesperson's portfolio of products along with dozens of others, and they said, go sell this. They stuck with it for 3 years in the market, and then they wrote it off for a loss. Mm-hmm. Complete write-off. About the time they're writing it off, Cisco introduces the CSR-1, exactly the same product. And they will both tell you they're the same product. They're still making money from the product today. What was different? Cisco took this product, and they realized that the buyers at the customer companies, both Telabs and Cisco, were going to the same customer companies. They needed to go to different buyers.
So they had incumbents in the organizations that they sold to. They thought, well, I'll just go back to
Telabs said, we're going to go back to the same people we always went to. Cisco said, you know what? Their value proposition is different. We need to go to the strategic planning people, not the ops people. And the strategic planning people bought it. Second thing they did differently is they assigned a small group of salespeople. To your point earlier, Ken, this is your full-time job for the next year. Sell this product and sell as much of it as you can. And this wasn't a big team. It was just a few people. And finally, they found an SVP, Senior Vice President, which is a solid title at Cisco. And they said, one of the things you have to shepherd next year, keep an eye on it, get this team whatever they need to make this successful. And so with the sponsorship, a full-time team, and a new value proposition to the customer, the product is still making money for them today.
Fantastic. You know, I think that notion of failure is interesting. And, you know, Ken, you've been on projects that have been successful, and you've been on projects, I'm sure, that have failed.
Contributed to some of those, unfortunately.
You did. The successes, that is, right? The failures were somebody else's problem. Yeah. What were some of the contributing factors to those projects that have failed?
The contributing factor for failures is also the same factor for success: lack of sponsorship. Lack of sponsorship is what will do it. Now, there's a somewhat of a technical aspect of project management. The literature will say that a poorly defined statement of work, and that's true. If you don't define what you want to do or what you want to build, you're not going to get there.
Yeah.
But if you don't have executive sponsorship, no matter how well you do all the other project management tools and techniques, mm-hmm. it's going to fail. You're going to need someone at that senior level. Mm-hmm. I call it who can kick butt and take names. You need that individual.
Yep.
I had two examples where it worked perfectly. I was working on an ERP deployment. It was a $100 million investment for the corporation. The project was really kind of going in the toilet, quite frankly. That's the failure. The senior vice president brought me in. I worked for the company. I remember in the room, he had 60 people around the table. And he says, Ken Atwood is going to be our program manager. My door is only open to him and no one else. If anyone has any questions, they need to find another job.
You need to bring him with you wherever you go.
It was silence, absolute silence. But the important thing about that, his name was Mike, is that we went from 70-some people to 7 the next week, and we got the project
good
going.
Good for you.
But the important thing about that, I never had to play that card. I never had to go to Rob and says, if you don't do this, I'm going to go talk to Mike. That was essential. That is absolutely essential. You're going nowhere without it. Yeah. Same thing with as you were talking about.
That's a great story.
You know, Rob, I did see one thing in the book that was interesting, and it was a new business design that was launched, but failed, and then restarted it. And I'm from Pennsylvania,
right,
I have Wawas everywhere I go.
That's right.
So,
known as my Wawa, right?
Yeah, my Wawa.
Right.
Don't mess with my Wawa.
Yeah,
but anyway,
right. Yeah.
And I want you to tell that story, and then I'd like to talk about when do you decide that just because a new business has failed, it might be worth restarting another way.
Well, I'll tell you the story quickly, but there's sort of a punchline to this story, and that is that Wawa, for those of you who don't know, I mean, maybe Ken, it's a very successful retail, think convenience store, but
okay.
It's a lot more than that. People love the Wawa in their area. The food quality is excellent. So an outsider doesn't really get the passion that the people who work for Wawa have and their customers who shop there. It's privately held. I believe they report about $4.5 billion in revenues. It's a good-sized company. Still owned by the family that founded it.
Really?
And so part of the reason this worked, that they were able to take something that I'll explain in a second that failed and then retry it again a decade later, was that there was a leader who had clear authority, who owned the company. Everybody mm-hmm. knew that he had everybody's best interests at heart, and he was able to say, I know there are objections. I know we went through this once before. We're going to do it again. And the outcome's been great. So here's what they were trying to do. They had great food service, made to order, basically stuff at their locations and other things that a convenience store would have. And they recognized that more and more gas retailers were going to convenience, largely because in order to make any money, you have to make it on other things. I mean, gas retailers make very little, believe it or not, they make very little from selling gasoline from a margin perspective. So they make their margin by you popping into the store and picking up a soda or chips or whatever you're going to do. And so they were experiencing increased competition, and they also saw a revenue opportunity. So they thought, for growth and also for competitive purposes, we need to get into gasoline. So they did that in the early 80s, and they did it sort of ham-handed, as they'll tell you. They did it, here's a store, let's throw some pumps out front,
and
we'll sell gas,
yep.
Right? And they did all the regulatory things, they're very careful about that. And it didn't succeed. The same store sales went down for things inside. They had big problems with the processes. It's very different running a gas station than it is from running a food operation. Some people were confused by, well, I like the food at Wawa, but I don't generally think of a gas station as a place where I'm going to get high quality food for lunch, for instance. So a range of issues. They pulled the plug. About 10 or 12 years later, Richard Wood, the chairman, the CEO at the time, and the owner of the company said, you know what? We need to try gas again, and we're going to do it differently this time. We're going to redesign the whole business approach. In fact, we're going to move into a new state and build brand new stores from scratch that optimize around this combination between our great retail stores and our gasoline. And so starting from scratch and designing the whole business with that in mind, they've had significant success in their new stores in Virginia, and now they're starting to look at their existing markets and how they might incorporate that into those stores.